a voice forever. Saying, who we go? Who we go? Calling us. With your Holy Spirit, take hold of us. Fill us with your love. Let your kingdom come. Your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Your will be done. There's a cry from heaven. Saying, oh, we stand, oh, we stand. Standing in a gap for nation. For it's loving hand, it's loving hand. Take hold of us.
Fill us with the Holy Spirit.
Take hold of us. Fill us with your love.
Let your kingdom come.
Your will be done. Let your kingdom come. Your will be done.
The Lord. I welcome everyone to our Bible study tonight in Jesus' name. I pray God will grant you and God will grant me, every one of us, deep revelation of his word. And the word of God will benefit and profit everyone. Give me a good, good amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the Bible study. We bless your name because of the faithfulness of your people, always coming and always learning. We pray, O Lord, that what we learn will be of tremendous benefit to us personally, and in our families, and in our ministries, in the whole church, in Jesus' name. Open our eyes of understanding that we may behold wondrous things out of your word in Jesus' name. Confirm your word, the promises there, the prophecies there, and the goodness there in every life in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' name we pray. We're coming to John chapter 18. We've been studying the gospel according to St. John. And we've gone through chapters 1 through to 17. Now we come to chapter 18. Tonight we're looking at verses 1 all through to 11. John chapter 18, open your Bible with me from verse 1. When Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook of Kidron, where was a garden, into the which he entered and his disciples, and Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place. For Jesus ofttimes resorted thither with his disciples. Judas then, having received a bunch of men and officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, cometh thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. And Jesus therefore, knowing all things that shall come upon him, went forth and said unto them, whom seek ye? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus says unto them, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. As soon then as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backward and fell to the ground. Then asked he them again, whom seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus answered, I have told you that I am he. If therefore you seek me, let these go their way, that the saying might be fulfilled, which is spake of them, which thou gavest me, have I lost none. Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it, and smote the high priest's servant, and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Then said Jesus unto Peter, put up thy sword into its sheath. The cup which my Father has given me, shall I not drink it? Those are the verses we're looking at today. And the topic that we're dealing with is Christ's willing submission as the perfect sacrifice. Christ's willing submission as the perfect sacrifice. As we come back to verse 1, look at the opening verse in verse 1. It says, when Jesus has spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples. Look at that. When he says he has spoken these words, what does that mean? He'd been talking to his own disciples. It was like an indoor meeting with those who are very close to him. And from chapter 13 through to chapter 17, the Lord Jesus Christ, I've been talking about a number of things. Number one, instruction. Number two, revelation. Number three, supplication. You'll see from chapter 13 and 14 and 15 and 16 and 17, he gave them instructions. what they ought to do, how they ought to demonstrate the life of the disciple and the love they ought to have one to another. But to also give them revelation, he said, the Comforter will be coming. And when that Comforter comes, he's going to reveal all truths unto them. Number one, instruction that he gave. Number two, revelation that he revealed unto them. Number three, supplication. He prayed for them. And the whole of chapter 17 is a prayer of the Lord Jesus Christ for his disciples. I want you to look at this a little bit more closely. As we look at the things that he is now telling them, because he said when he has spoken all these things, and you want to understand that this time now, Judas Iscariot was not there. He led in chapter 13. Let me show you. We're looking at chapter 13 of John, and we're looking at verse 2. John chapter 13, we're looking at verse 2. And supper being ended, the devil, having put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Then look at verse 30 of that same chapter 13. In verse 30, it tells us, it says, he then, having received the sup, went immediately out, and it was night. And so, all through then, chapter 14, 15, 16, 17, Judas was absent. He now came back in chapter 18. Come to chapter 18, we're looking at verse 3. Judas then, having received a bunch of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, commence hither, thither, with lanterns and torches and weapons. And so you have this in the study of the word of God, revelation of the word of God, instruction from the word of God, and the supplication, the prayer for the sanctification of the believers all the time that Judas Iscariot had been away. Come back to that chapter 18 again, verse 1. When Jesus has spoken these words, he has spoken these words. You want to remind yourself, what are those words he has spoken to them? Number one, he spoke about salvation. Look at chapter 15, verse 3. It says, now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Then look at chapter 17, verse 2. As thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to all, to as many as thou hast given him. He spoke about salvation. He spoke about the fact that they had eternal life. He spoke about the fact that now they were clean. Even though he was still to go to the cross and die for everyone and die for them, the benefit of Calvary was already theirs. They had salvation. Have that in your mind. And then number two, he spoke about separation from the world. Look at what he says in chapter 15. After speaking these words, these were the things he had confirmed before now coming to chapter 18. In chapter 15, reading here from verse 18, it says, if the world hates you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world would love its own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. They were separated from the world. He confirmed that to them and to the Father. In chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 14. It says, I have given them thy word, and the world has hated them. Why? Because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but that thou shouldest keep them from the evil. Verse 16, they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. He emphasized that these people had been saved. They turned away from their sins, and they were now different from the worldly people. They were not of the world. And then he showed them the only way to heaven. All through this time that Judas Iscariot went away, he was telling them, this is the only way, the way to heaven. Chapter 14, we're looking at verse 6. In chapter 14, verse 6, it says here in verse 6, Jesus says unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. You see, he wanted them to have the foundational truths of the word of God, that to get into the kingdom of God, they had to understand that he was the only way, the only savior, the only begotten son of God who could take them from earth to heaven. Number one, he spoke about salvation. Number two, he spoke about separation from the world. Number three, he spoke about the only way, and he was the only way that leads to heaven. Number four, he spoke about obedience of the true believer. That is, you are born again, you are a child of God. Now you are clean through the word as spoken unto you, and you have eternal life because you have come to the Lord, and you know assuredly that he is the one that has eternal life. What follows then? Obedience to the word of God. It was that obedience that will show that they actually are not just head knowledge, but they had experience with the Lord. It tells us in chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 17. Chapter 13, verse 17, it says, if you know these things, happy are ye if you do them. The only way you can be happy, a child of God, assured you're a child of God, have the joy of a child of God, is that you're obedient to the word of God. And then he prayed for them, and before praying for them, he spoke about love. Love as the evidence of true discipleship. It tells us in chapter 13, chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 34, chapter 13 of John. We're looking at verse 34, the evidence of true discipleship, the evidence that you're really following after the Lord. I will follow Jesus, I will follow Jesus, no turning back, no turning back. What's the implication of that? The implication of that is that you have love in the heart. Chapter 13, verse 34, it says, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another. It says, by thee shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one towards another. And then he spoke to them and assured them of sanctification and oneness. Oneness with the Father, oneness with Jesus Christ himself, the sanctifier, and oneness with one another. Look at John chapter 17. John chapter 17, verse 9. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. And then he tells us in verse 17, sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. Verse 20, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word. He emphasized sanctification, and he said that sanctification will bring them into oneness with him, Christ, the Savior, the Sanctifier. I'll bring them in oneness with one another. Look at verse 21, that they all may be one. Even as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. In all this period, after Judas Iscariot had left and was telling them about this, number one, instruction, number two, revelation, number three, supplication, he emphasized to them of the coming of the Holy Ghost, the baptism in the Holy Ghost. He tells us in chapter 14, in chapter 14, it tells us, reading from verse 16 and verse 17, it says, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may be and abide with you forever. It says, even the Spirit of truth, that the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of truth, the truthful Spirit, whom the Father, whom the world cannot receive. It's saying that those who are not born again cannot receive this Holy Ghost. Those who are not born again cannot be seeking for the baptism in the Holy Ghost. Number one, there is salvation. Number two, there's sanctification. And after that sanctification, there is the Holy Ghost baptism, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him. For he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. Look at verse 26 of that chapter 14. It says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. That's why it's important for them and for us too to be saved, to be sanctified, and to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, because it is when that Holy Ghost comes, he will teach you all things, and then he'll bring to your remembrance all things whatsoever I have said unto you. Look at chapter 15, verse 26. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceeded from the Father, he shall testify of me. Come to chapter 16, verse 7. In chapter 16, verse 7, it says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And then he goes on to say, in verse 12, I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Verse 13, howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come. You're saved, good. You don't have it all yet. You're sanctified, that's wonderful. You don't have it all yet. But when he, the Spirit of truth, when you are baptized in the Holy Ghost, when he's come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall speak, shall hear, that shall he also speak, and he will show you things to come. He also told them about their power in prayer, unlimited power in prayer they were going to have. He told them in chapter 14, I'm reading from verse 12. Chapter 14, reading from verse 12, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than this shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And he says, whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask, tell me over there, anything in my name, what will happen? I will do it. And then he told them he was coming back again. He was going now. He was going to be betrayed. That's not the end. He was going to be crucified. He will die. He will be buried. He'll rise the third day. But that will not be the end. After rising, he'll ascend to heaven. And then he will come again. Look at chapter 14, verse 1. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. He's going to prepare a place for you. And he'll come back for you. If you are saved, I said he'll come back for you. You are sanctified, he'll come back for you. And you are baptized in the Holy Ghost, and you are working for the Lord, laboring for the kingdom, he'll come back for you in Jesus' name. Look at verse 3. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. I will come again. He's coming again. And then he says, and I receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And so now chapter 18 is a beginning a new section. All that we have gone through now is what he had taught them, is what he had revealed to them. That's why verse 1, chapter 18 begins with when Jesus had spoken these words. And what we have done now is to remind ourselves of the words that he has spoken, the instruction that he had given. And also we have reminded ourselves of the supplication of the prayer he prayed for them. When Jesus had spoken these words, then he went forth with his disciples over the brook Kidron, and where there was a garden, into the which he entered and his disciples. As I said tonight, we're looking at Christ's willing submission as the perfect sacrifice. Three things we're going to look at in the passage in chapter 18, verses 1 to 11 today. Number one, the willful sin of an irredeemable pervert. The first section tells us about Judas Iscariot. He was one of those disciples, but then he willfully backslid. And then he stayed in that backsliding. He became a pervert. He became a betrayer. And the first five verses is talking about him, the willful sinner of an irredeemable pervert. Point number two, his willing submission. Talking about Christ, how he submitted. Talking about Christ as Savior. Talking about Christ as substitute. His willing submission despite his irresistible power. Mighty and powerful. great miracle worker. And he could have commanded angels from heaven, and he'll deal with all those officers and the bunch that came. But no, he willingly submitted, and he willingly gave himself his willing submission despite his irresistible power. Point number three, you find in verses 10 and 11 talking about Peter the apostle. Peter, that vocal and confident disciple, and you know, in this place now, he dropped his sword, and then he cut off the ear of the servant of the high priest. And Jesus took the ear and put it back and told him, if you carry the sword, you'll perish with the sword. Point number three, the worldly struggle of an inconsistent person. The worldly struggle that is struggling and fighting and trying to defend the Lord Jesus Christ so Jesus will not be arrested. And he was an inconsistent person, because Jesus had said, I'm going to be crucified. And the people now came. He said, I'm going to be betrayed. And the people now came. He said, there's one of you here you're going to betray. He's going to betray me. And the people now came. And Peter forgot everything Jesus had told them. And Jesus had told him, he was so inconsistent. The worldly struggle of an inconsistent person. We're coming to number one. What's number one over there? The willful sin of an irredeemable pervert. I want you to look at chapter 18 again. And we're reading from verse 1. It says, when Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook Kidron, where was a garden, into the which he entered and his disciples. And Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place. For Jesus of times resorted thither with his disciples. Look at verse 3. Judas then, having received a bunch of men and others from the chief priests and Pharisees, cometh thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. And then in verse 5, Jesus therefore, knowing that all things that should come, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth, and he said unto them, whom seek ye? He wasn't running away. He faced them. He knew they were coming. He knew the betrayer would be there. And he knew that they would arrest him. He knew what they were going to do. And he went forth to them voluntarily. They didn't have to search for him, because he voluntarily gave himself. And then in verse 5, it says, they answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus says unto them, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, tell me, stood with them, stood with the people that had come to arrest the Lord Jesus Christ, so that they could betray him and so that they could crucify him. As we look at Judas Iscariot, he wasn't ignorant of what Jesus Christ had said. And Jesus had told him that Satan was going to do this. He could have resisted Satan, but no, he didn't. He didn't want to do that. Look at chapter 13. I'm reading from chapter 13, verse 2. Talking about this pervert, talking about this backslider, talking about this reprobate, talking about this one that are falling away from the truth, and falling away from everything he ever learned, he ever heard, he ever experienced. We're looking at John chapter 13, verse 2. It says, and supper being ended, the devil having now put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Who put it in the heart of Judas Iscariot? Was it God that influenced him, that compelled him? Whether you like it or not, you must be a betrayer. Whether you like it or not, you must get into this condemnation. Whether you like it or not, you must betray my only begotten son. Was it the Almighty God that did that? No, it says Satan put it in his heart. Let's come back to verse 27. That's chapter 13 of John, verse 27. After the sob, Satan entered into him. Who entered into Judas Iscariot? And then, said Jesus unto him, that thou doest, do quickly. Now no man at the table knew for what intent he spake this unto him. For some of them thought, because Judas Iscariot at the bag, that is, was the treasurer of the team, of the assembly, of the people of God there. And it says that Jesus had said unto him, that's what they thought, by those things that we have need of against the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. Verse 30, he then, having received the sop, went immediately out, and it was night. That was the man. He became a backslider. It wasn't like that before. It was one of the 12 that the Lord sent out two by two so that they'll preach the word of repentance. Look at this in chapter 17, verse 12. Chapter 17, verse 12. While I was with them in the world, I kept them by thy name. They were saved, I kept them. They had repented, I kept them. They came into the kingdom, I kept them. When temptations came, they appealed to me and prayed, I kept them. When they could have backslidden, I kept them. I kept them through thy name. Those that thou gavest me, I have kept. And none of them is lost. But, tell me, the son of perdition. That's what he became. A pervert, the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. But you know, the Lord had warned him. Come to Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26, you'll see all the communication, the interaction, the instruction, the warning that the Lord Jesus Christ had given him, but he wasn't listening. It's not enough to just hear. It's not enough to just be at the Bible study. We must listen. Thank God you are listening. Must apply it to our hearts. Thank God you'll apply it to your heart. And then we pray it in and we pray it through so that the power in the word will work in every one of our lives. And when the temptation comes, when the trial comes, when the possibility comes that the devil is saying, turn back, we'll say, no way, I will not turn back. I said, I will not turn back. But look at him, he had all the warning, and he had everything, but he would not take it. We're looking at Matthew chapter 26, and we're reading from verse 20. Matthew chapter 26, and we're reading here from verse 20. Now, when the evening was come, he sat down with the 12. Judas was still there. And as they did eat, he said, verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. He didn't come by surprise. And Judas will not say, he had not heard that before. He said, one of you will betray me. And they were exceeding sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, is it I? Is it I? Am I planning something like that? Am I thinking something like that? Is the devil trying to hoodwink me and then make me to betray my Lord, my Savior, and I didn't know? Is it I? Look at verse 23. And he answered and said, he that dippeth a sandwich with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. Can you see how close he was to the Lord Jesus Christ? And they ate together, not only on the same table, but they ate even from the same plate. The Son of Man goeth as it is written of him. But, tell me out aloud, what to that man? Look at this, look at the warning, and look at the seriousness and the severity of the warning. Woe unto him, unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. He says, it had been good for that man if he had not been born. Terrible. It was anybody that will do this will go to hell. And even though the Lord Jesus Christ said this, the man will not listen. That's why I will say it was a willful sin. It was something he did deliberately. Look at verse 47. In verse 47 of that same chapter, it says, and while he yet spake, Judas, one of the 12, came, and with him a great multitude of swords and staves gifts from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now, he that betrayed him gave them a sign, saying, whomsoever I shall kiss, that same is he. Hold him fast. Look at what he was telling the enemies about the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, let's go, I'll kiss him. And then when I kiss him, you know that that is the man, hold him fast. Don't let him go. And it says, and forthwith he came to Jesus and said, hail, master, and kissed him. And Jesus said unto him, what?
Friend.
Wherefore art thou come? Then came they and laid hands on Jesus, and they took him. But look at verse 55. It says in verse 55, in that same hour said Jesus to the multitude, are ye come out as against a thief with swords and staves to take me? I sat daily with you teaching in the temple, and ye laid no hands on me. Now, as we look at the scene of Judas Iscariot, let's see what the Bible says about such a scene. That is a scene that is kind of willful. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 10, reading from verse 26. Hebrews chapter 10, reading from verse 26. It says in verse 26, for if we sin willfully, if we sin deliberately, if we sin flagrantly, if we sin with an adamant mind and with a rebellious spirit, even though we've had the warning, even though we know that this is evil, even though we know that this will lead to perdition, will lead to hell, if we sin willfully, after that we have received the knowledge of the truth. Judas had the knowledge of the truth, that Jesus is a Savior, that Jesus is the Lamb of God, that came to take the sin of the world away. He knew even the evil spirits were testifying, this is the Holy One of God. Judas knew all about that, and yet it says, if we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remains no more sacrifice for sin. It says in verse 27, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Look at verse 29 now. Of how much sorer punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy, who has trodden underfoot the Son of God, and has counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified. It's not only Judas Iscariot, there are people like that. They've come into the gospel, they believe the Lord Jesus Christ, they were saved, they were born again. In fact, the Bible says here, they were sanctified by the blood of the Lamb. And then eventually they turn around, and as they turned around, they count that blood of the covenant wherewith they were sanctified an unholy thing, and they have done despite to the spirit of grace. They rejected the grace of God. They said, I don't want anything of that anymore. And when they become like that, they have sinned willfully. And it says in verse 30, for we know him that has said, vengeance belongeth unto me, I will recompense, says the Lord. And again, the Lord shall judge his people. And then in verse 31, it is a fearful sin to fall into the hands of the living God. I pray that will not happen to you. Judas Iscariot was warned, but he chose the way of perdition. He chose to be lost. He heard the saving truth from Christ. He saw the miracles of the Lord Jesus Christ. He took part in the evangelistic ministry with the disciples, and he even had a conspicuous position among the apostles, because he was the one that carried the bag. He was the treasurer of the disciples, and he learned much about heaven. He learned much about hell from the very lips of the Lord Jesus Christ. He knew Christ to be innocent. He knew Christ to be sinless. He knew Christ to be perfect. And he received direct warning from Christ, yet He chose to perish. He chose to perish. Why did he do that? How could he do that? We're coming to 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. We're reading from verse 5. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, reading from verse 5, look at what it says. Perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds, destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness. From such, tell me. From such, say what you will do. From such, say it aloud. You will draw yourself in Jesus' name. Look at verse 9. It says, but they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful laws, which drown men in destruction and perdition. That was his problem. He wanted money by all means. Look at verse 10. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Verse 11, but thou, O man of God, flee these things. Amen. Amen. Follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and meekness. What was the problem of Judas Iscariot? He loved money more than he loved the master. Check up in your own heart. What do you love more than the Messiah? What do you love more than the Savior? Number two, he loved self more than the Savior. He was thinking about himself. I want money. I want this. I want silver and gold. And just that, because of that, he sold his soul into the hands of Satan. Number three, he loved the bag more than his birthright. The fact that you are born again and you become a new creature in Christ, that should be the most important thing to you. And you carry your salvation, and you protect your salvation, and you embrace your salvation, and you keep that salvation, and you know that whatever will go, I must not lose my salvation. But in the case of Judas Iscariot, he loved the bag more than his birthright. He loved earthly gain more than eternal glory. The Lord had told them, you are the 12 following after me, and you are forsaking everything. You will reign on the 12 tribes of Israel, and you'll be with me in my kingdom. That eternal glory he forgot. That eternal glory he jettisoned. That eternal glory he relegated to the background, because he loved earthly gain more than eternal glory. He loved gold more than godliness. Gold more than godliness. He wasn't thinking about godliness. He wasn't thinking about grace. He wasn't thinking about getting to heaven. Gold, gold, gold. That's all what he wanted. And eventually he lost his soul. I pray you'll not lose your soul. Nothing in this world will make you give up your salvation in Jesus' name. He loved riches more than righteousness. He loved riches more than righteousness. That's why he went to those officers. That's why he went to the Pharisees. And he said, what are you going to give me? And he covenanted with them that he will have that amount of money. He loved the world more than the world. The word of God coming unto him. And Peter said, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the word of eternal life. To whom shall we go? We're going to abide with you. We're going to stay with you. But in the case of Judas Iscariot, he said, what am I going to do with the word when the world is there and I want to gain the world? And Jesus had told them, what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall he give in exchange for his soul? He loved the world more than the world. You know, those Pharisees, those Sadducees, those people that wanted to catch Jesus and crucify him and kill him, what Caiaphas, who said, it's expedient for one man to die for the nation so that religion can continue. They were against Christ. And when you are against Christ, that's antichrist. They were antichrist. And Judas says, God went to these antichrists because he loved the antichrists more than he loved Christ. Look at our world today. The people that are against Christ, opposed to Christ, they are antichrist, in their principle, their antichrist, in their whatever they are doing, their antichrist, in whatever they are proposing or the work they are doing. And there are people that love those antichrists more than the law of Christ. Is walking in the way of Judas Iscariot. I pray you will not be there. I said, I pray you will not be there. And you will not walk the way of evil in Jesus' name. I want you to look at Zechariah chapter 7. Zechariah chapter 7. And so you will understand the real problem here. After he committed that willful sin and he remained there. Look at what the Lord had said. Zechariah chapter 7. I'm reading here from verse 12. Zechariah chapter 7, verse 12. Yea, they made their hearts as an adamant stone. It's not God who made them that way, and it's not anybody that made them that way. This is the person making a choice, because I must get the gold, I must keep the bag, I must have the money, I must have the riches, I must have this, I don't care what I lose, I must have this. And because of that, they made their hearts as an adamant stone, lest they should hear the law, the word of God, and the words which the Lord of hosts has sent in his spirit by the former prophets. Therefore came a great wrath from the Lord of hosts. Therefore, it is come to pass that as he cried, it's come to pass as he cried, Christ, the Lord Jesus cried in the Garden of Gethsemane. And then he was so sorrowful almost unto death. And he was even sweating to blood as a sweat. But Judas Iscariot will not care about all that. As he cried, and they would not hear so, they cried, and I would not hear, says the Lord of hosts. I pray that you'll not get to that point. Look at now, Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. Reading from verse 25. It says in verse 25, Acts of the Apostles chapter 1, reading from verse 25, that she may take part of this ministry and apostleship from which Judas by transgression fell. How did he fall? I said, how did Judas fall? Was he born again before? Was he a child of God before? If you don't, if you are not up, you cannot fall. If you're on the ground, you cannot say you are falling, because you've always been on the ground. He was off the ground. He was in the grace of God. He was saved. He was up there. But it says, by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. What's his place? Hellfire. You will not be there in Jesus' name. Point number two now is willing submission despite his irresistible power. We're talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, as the people came and they were going to arrest the Lord Jesus Christ. And then we see the willing submission of the Lord Jesus Christ, because he'll be our substitute, because he'll be our sacrifice, because he will be our savior. We're coming to chapter 18 and we're reading from verse 6. Chapter 18 of John, verse 6. It says, as soon then as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backward and fell to the ground. Then asked he them again, who seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus answered, I have told you that I am he. If therefore you seek me, let these go their way, that the saying might be fulfilled which he spake of them which thou gavest me, I lost none. Now you see here the Lord Jesus Christ, he could have called legions of angels from heaven and could have dealt with these people. Apart from that, he had the power, he had the authority, and you will see the power that came out from him. He just stood there without doing anything or saying anything, and he said, who are you looking for? They said, we're looking for Jesus of Nazareth. And when he said, I am he, they fell to the ground and they fell backwards. Even at that point of betrayal, even at the point of arrest, he had all the power and all the authority, and he had all the angels at his command. He had a miracle working power that would arrest those people and destroy those people, but he voluntarily gave himself and he did not resist. He surrendered. You know what he did? He chose to surrender and to submit. Why? He wants to be our savior. Why? He wants to be a substitute. Why? He wants to be that acceptable sacrifice in the hands of the Father. The officers and the whole bunch fell backwards to the ground. And calmly and courageously, he exposed himself unto them. He revealed himself unto them. He could have escaped when all of them fell to the ground and they fell backwards. He could have escaped, but no, he would not escape. You know why? He chose to surrender and to submit. He said, I'm the lamb. I'm the sacrificial lamb. And I'm going to submit myself. They didn't force him. They couldn't have taken him. They couldn't have arrested him if he didn't give himself. He was not thinking of the moment. He was thinking, you know, of the divine decision before the foundation of the world. And he was thinking of the future joy after fulfilling the purpose of his being the acceptable, final, perfect sacrifice. So he chose to surrender and he chose to submit. And let's see what he had said earlier. We're looking at John chapter 10. John chapter 10, and we're reading from verse 17. John chapter 10, verse 17. It says, therefore, does my Father love me because I lay down my life that I might take it again? I lay down my life. I lay down my life. It was something he did voluntarily. It was something he did happily. It was something he did by himself. Look at verse 18. No man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself, voluntary. This was a willing submission that he did, even though he had the power to have resisted. But he said, no man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. He wanted to do the will of the Father. And the will of the Father is that he will die for the sins of the whole world. Look at Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, we're reading from verse 7. In Hebrews chapter 10, reading from verse 7, it tells us he came to do the will of the Father. Look at verse 7. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me to do thy will, O God. I come to do thy will, O God. Look at verse 8 above. When he said sacrifice and offering and burnt offerings and offering for sin, thou wouldest not, neither hadst thou pleasure therein, wherein which are offered by the law. That is all those sacrifices of the Old Testament, because they could not take away sin. And they were not powerful enough to purge and to preserve and to perfect and to make man live victoriously day after day and month after month and year after year, courageously and triumphantly. Because those sacrifices were not effective, Christ now came and said, I will do it. I'll give myself. Look at verse 9. Then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second. That is, he took away the first covenant, the old covenant, so that he can establish the new covenant. Look at verse 10. By the which will were sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. He did that for you. He did that for me. And he did it by himself voluntarily. Look at Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2. Reading from verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not to be robbery to be equal with God. Equal with God, I and my Father are one. And yet he left heaven, he left the glory above, and he gave his life, and he gave up everything to come and die for us. Remember, he did it voluntarily, of his own volition. Look at verse 7. But he made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself. He did it himself. He humbled himself. He surrendered himself. He submitted himself to the death of the cross of Calvary. He said, this is what I want to do for your salvation, for my salvation, and for the salvation of the whole of humanity. He says, being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Why was he doing that? Because he was making himself a sacrifice. Remember that, a sacrifice. You don't need any other sacrifice. The sacrifice of Jesus was available for you and is sufficient for you. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. It says, purge out therefore the old leaven, that she may be a new lump, as she are unleavened. For even Christ, look at this, even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. It says, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And as you turn away from sin and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and apply by faith his blood upon your own heart, upon your own soul, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Ephesians chapter 5, Ephesians chapter 5, reading from verse 2. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2, emphasizing the fact that Jesus Christ made himself the sacrifice. Look at this, and walk in love, as Christ also has loved us and has given himself. They didn't take him by force. He was the one that gave himself. He has given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for his worst men. He ain't save him. It's repeatedly told us that Jesus Christ submitted himself as sacrifice. I pray you receive him fully. All your heart, all your soul, all your mind, you concentrate on that and know that he has sacrificed himself for you, and now that sacrifice will avail for you in Jesus' name. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26, it says, for then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world, as he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. That's why he did what he did, to put away sin, your sin, to put away sin, the sin of your whole family, to put away sin, the sin of your whole community, to put away sin, the sin of the world. Anyone that will come to the Lord Jesus Christ today can have all his sins put away because the sacrifice had been made. Come to chapter 10, Hebrews chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 10. Hebrews chapter 10, reading from verse 12, rather, in verse 12, but this man, referring to Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice, that's why he submitted himself, that's why he surrendered himself, that's why he gave himself, after he had offered one sacrifice for sin forever, sat down on the right hand of God. Look at verse 14, for by one offering, as he perfected forever them that are sanctified. He'll sanctify you. Now, why did he make himself the sacrifice? Let's see the reason why he was sacrificed. We're looking at 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 6. 1 Timothy chapter 2, we're reading from verse 6. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 6, look at this, and you want to see that he gave himself, he gave himself, he gave himself. In all these passages, look at this, verse 6, who gave himself a ransom for how many people? For all, to be testified in due time. He gave himself, he gave himself, so that you will be saved. You will not be lost. Galatians chapter 1, Galatians chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 4. Galatians chapter 1, verse 4, he gave himself, verse 4, who gave himself. You see that again? That's why he surrendered. That's why he died. That's why he submitted himself to those people that came to arrest him, who gave himself for our sins, because of our sins, that he might deliver us from the present evil world according to the will of God, our Father. He will deliver you. And then he tells us in Galatians, Galatians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 20. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I am crucified with Christ.
Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and did what? Gave himself for me. Gave himself for me. You don't have to perish in sin. You don't have to continue in sin. He gave himself for you so that he will give his life to you. And the life you now live, you live by the faith of the Son of God. He loved you and gave himself for you. We're coming to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 25. Ephesians chapter 5, he gave himself for you. Why? Look at it here. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church. And what did he do? He gave himself for it. It's repeated over and over that this is the reason why Jesus died for your salvation. He gave himself. For sanctification, he gave himself. And for you to overcome, have the victory over the world, he gave himself. Look at this. Who gave himself for it and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any sort of sin, but that it should be holy and without blemish. You will be holy. You can be holy everywhere. Your place of work, you can be holy. At home, you can be holy. When you are alone by yourself and there's nobody there, you can be holy. You'll be holy in Jesus' name. Look at Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 14. Remember, he gave himself, he gave himself, he gave himself. He gave himself for you. Look at Titus chapter 2, verse 14. Who gave himself for us? That he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Have you seen that? We're going to read that, make it personal now. Who gave himself for me? Who gave himself for me? That he might redeem me from all iniquity. That he might redeem me from all iniquity. And purify me unto himself. Purify me unto himself. A peculiar person. I am a peculiar person. Zealous of good works. You know, you need to read that over and over. Get on your knees and open to Titus chapter 2 verse 14. And say, he gave himself for me. He gave himself for me. I'm waiting for you. He gave himself for me. That he might redeem me from how many iniquities? That he might redeem me from all iniquity. And purify me unto himself. A peculiar person. Zealous of good works. That's why he died. He will effect it. He will accomplish that in your life in Jesus' name. Point number 3, we're coming now to John chapter 18. And we're reading from verses 10 and 11. John chapter 18. We're reading from verses 10 and 11. The third point, the worldly struggle of an inconsistent person. We're coming to John chapter 18, and we're reading from verses 9, from verses 10 and 11. Remember now, the people who wanted to arrest Jesus, they have come, and Judas Iscariot is there, standing with them, and Jesus had revealed himself unto them, I am he. And now what were they going to do? They were going to stretch forth their hand and capture Jesus and take him away so that he'll be crucified. Look at verse 10. Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and smote the high priest's servant and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Then said Jesus unto Peter, listen to this, put up thy sword into the sheath. The cup which my father has given me, shall I not drink it? Are you trying to prevent me from drinking the cup which the father has given me? Are you trying to prevent the purpose and to hinder the purpose for which I came to this world? Don't you understand this is why I came? Don't you understand? I'm the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. And now they're coming to take the Lamb. And they're coming, they're going to sacrifice that Lamb so that there'll be the salvation for the whole of humanity. Peter, what are you doing? Are you trying to hinder me from doing what my Father has ordained that I should do? Now let's understand. Peter became a great apostle after he experienced Pentecost. And Peter was a person that was notably used of God from Acts chapter 1, Acts chapter 2, all through to Acts chapter 9, and then chapter 2, you see the miracle that happened. So we're not talking about Peter after Pentecost. We're looking at Peter before Pentecost. And there's three we're doing that. Number one is recorded in the Word of God. Matthew records it, Mark records it, Luke records it, and here we have John recording it for us, that this was something that happened through Peter at this time. We're learning what any of us could be before Pentecost. And before you experience Pentecost, this is how you are. And before anyone experiences Pentecost, this is how everyone is. That is telling us we need to revisit Calvary so that we will make sure that our experience of salvation, sanctification is intact. It cleanses our heart. It changes us and turns us around. And after we are sanctified, we need to go through and go further and tarry for the experience of the baptism in the Holy Ghost at Pentecost. Because after Pentecost, this one did not happen again, will not happen again in your life in Jesus' name. At this time now, as we look at Peter, we're looking at these two verses. Number one, he was incompatible with Christ. Incompatible with Christ. Christ surrendered himself. Christ yielded himself. And Christ says, the cup my Father has given me to drink, I will drink. Number one, he was incompatible. Number two, he was incorrigible. Incorrigible. Because you see, the Lord had revealed he was going to die. And at that time, look at Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, look at what had happened at that time. Matthew chapter 16, verse 21. It says, from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem. He, what's the next word there? Must go, must go. This is what the Father decided from all eternity, that is from before the foundation of the world. He must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day. Look at verse 22. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord, that they shall not be unto thee. Verse 23, but he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, what? Satan, for thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things which be of God, but those that be of men. Peter, this Peter, was incorrigible. Number three, he was inflexible. Inflexible. That means that's the thing he had in the head. That's what he had in the mind. And whatever Jesus Christ said, was he not at the table? When Jesus said, one of you will betray me. And then Jesus added, the Son of Man goeth as it was ordained for him to go. But woe to that man through whom the Son of Man is betrayed. But now Peter being inflexible. Just he only knew that this is what to do. They cannot take Jesus Christ. They cannot arrest Jesus Christ. And they cannot take Jesus away from there to go and crucify him. Number one, incompatible. Ask yourself, are you compatible with the Lord Jesus Christ? A good partner, a good follower, a good disciple. And then you will do whatever it takes he wants to do. And then he was incorrigible. Are you corrigible? Can we correct you? Can the word of God correct you? He was incorrigible. He was inflexible. He was independent. You see, Christ was thinking this way, he was thinking the other way. He was thinking, although Jesus said he's going to be taken, he's going to be betrayed, and he's going to be crucified, that's what he think, but I am independent in my thinking. I'm not going to allow that to happen. He was intractable. You couldn't silence him, you couldn't stop him, and you couldn't check him. You couldn't say, Peter, that's not right, that's not the way, don't go that way. He was intractable, but was irresolute. You know, this time now he's drawing out his sword and he's cutting off an ear, but the next time you are going to hear him when people say, are you not one of them? Did I not see you in the garden? And said, no, you didn't see me there, I'm not one of them. He was a kind of inconsistent, and that's why we're talking about the worldly struggle of an inconsistent person. I pray you will not be like that. But you know, ultimately he became entirely sanctified. Ultimately he tarried at the upper room, and then he had the power of the Holy Ghost, and when they challenged him and said, by what name have you done this, he said, if you are asking us how we did this, it is by the name of Jesus Christ, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. That's the name that has done this. And then he said, and there's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved but by the name of Jesus Christ. He came from that area and he came to the mountaintop. He became strong. You are going to become strong. And let's look at Matthew chapter 26. I'm reading from verse 51. Matthew chapter 26, and we're reading from verse 51. In verse 51, he's still telling us about the same thing. It says, and behold, one of them, he said, which while with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew out his sword. What's his name? I said, what's his name? Have you noticed that John mentioned his name and said it's Peter? But Matthew, in writing, did not mention his name. You know, sometimes you wonder when you read these accounts, why did Matthew write this, did not mention his name, and John wrote that and mentioned his name? You see, Matthew wrote the gospel according to St. Matthew when Peter was still alive. And you know, Matthew wanted to tell the story that somebody, one of those disciples, took the sword and cut off the ear of the chief priest, but he would not mention the name. When John the apostle, when he wrote his own gospel in AD 96, Peter had died, and now mentioning his name, no problem. The person that drew the sword, what does John say is his name? Peter. But Matthew will not mention. Come back now, verse 51. And behold, one of them, which were with Jesus, stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck a servant of the high priest and smote his ear. Then said Jesus unto him, it says, put up again thy sword into its place, for all that take the sword, tell me, shall perish with the sword. You understand that? He was defending Jesus Christ, although against the will of God. There are some people, they say, I'm doing something good, I have a good purpose, I'm protecting the church, I'm protecting this, I'm protecting that, I'm protecting Christ, I'm protecting Christianity, and they kill. And Jesus said, Peter, don't do that, because whatever the reason you have, he that takes up the sword, by man shall his life be taken also by the sword. Look at verse 53. Thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then shall the scripture be fulfilled that thus it must be. And so you see what the Lord is saying. He's saying that this should not be like that. Peter, don't do that. Look at John, and you see the reason why the Lord Jesus Christ was saying and emphasizing what he was saying and emphasizing. We're looking at John chapter 18. John chapter 18, I'm reading from verse 36. John chapter 18, verse 36. Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not of this world." You see, there's a way the kingdoms of the world, there's a way they behave, there's a way they act. And when they want to fight for their right, there's a way they fight for their right. When they want to defend and protect, there's a way they do that. But Jesus said they do that in the kingdom of the world. But he said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then my servants would do what? They'll fight." But he says, "My kingdom is not of this world." And those who are walking in the kingdom of God, those who are walking in the church, those who are walking in evangelism, those who are walking in with developing the church, edifying the church, helping the church, and making the church to grow, we cannot do it like they do it in the world. We cannot apply worldly system or worldly wisdom or worldly power or worldly technique, because it says, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered unto the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence." I pray we'll learn the lesson in Jesus' name. The Lord is telling us we should not try to avenge ourselves. We should leave vengeance in the hands of the Lord. We're coming to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 19. Romans chapter 12, reading from verse 19. "Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves." You know what the Lord was telling Peter? You're trying to avenge. You're trying to say, "Okay, Peter, I saw Judas Iscariot there." Judas Iscariot? What are you doing there? So you are the one Jesus was talking about, and then you come to betray him. Okay, you have applied that method. I'll fight back. Jesus said, "Don't fight back. You'll not fight back. For yourself, you'll not fight back. For your family, you'll not fight back. For holding a position, holding a title, you will not fight back in Jesus' name." Remember, you are the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of Christ, the kingdom of God, is not like the kingdom of this world. So that you don't do what you do in the world, dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord." Praise the Lord. And then he said, "Therefore, if thine enemy hunger," tell me, "feed." If thine enemy hunger, feed. If thine enemy hunger, feed. You are not ready? Feed. Are you ready?
Yes.
Do you have the mind of Christ? And do you have the nature of Christ? No.
Yes.
Look at it, verse 20, verse 20. "Therefore, if thine enemy hunger,
feed
him. If he thirst, give him drink, for in so doing thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good." Let me show you what happened. Look at Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22, and I'm reading from verse 47. Luke chapter 22, verse 47. Luke chapter 22, open your Bible, reading from verse 47. "And while he yet spake, behold, a multitude. And he that was called," what's his name? "Judas, one of the 12, went before them and drew near unto Jesus to kiss him. And Jesus said unto him, Judas, betrayest thou the Son of Man with a kiss?" In verse 49, "When they which were about him saw what would follow, they said unto him, Lord, shall we smite them? Shall we smite with the sword? And one of them, not waiting for an answer, one of them smote the servant of the high priest and cut off his right ear." What's his name? "And Jesus answered and said, Suffer ye thus far. And he touched his ear and," tell me,
"feed.
If thine enemy hunger,
feed.
If he thirst,
feed.
What did Jesus do? That's what he did. When he cut off the ear, you know, his milk walking power was still there. That he surrendered himself, that they arrested him, and that they took him away, doesn't mean that he was weak. No, he was not weak. He said, I'm meek and lowly. The power was still there. And yet, when he was arrested, and Peter cut off the ear, Jesus took that ear, put it back again, and performed a miracle. But you see, all these people, they were so adamant in the work, in the evil work they wanted to do, they didn't see that miracle. They didn't think of that miracle. They still arrested him, and they still took him away. But the point is, we will be like Jesus. You will be like Jesus. Our weapons are not carnal weapons to begin to fight with cudgels and a stick and whatever and weaves and then say we're going to fight it out. No, we're not going to fight. We're going to apply faith. We're looking at 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I'm reading here from verse 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. We're looking at verse 3. It says, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. The sticks, that's carnal. The sword, that's carnal. And all the physical things people are using, that's carnal. And using the pen to slay somebody, to kill somebody, or to betray somebody, that's carnal. But it says, but the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every thought and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Well, apply spiritual means in Jesus' name. Ephesians chapter 6, Ephesians chapter 6, don't carry sword, don't carry stick, and don't carry physical weapons to say you want to fight for the gospel, you are contending for the faith once delivered unto sins, and then you are slapping somebody, you are using the belt, and then you are, you know, knocking somebody. Don't do that. That's carnal. And that is not of God. It's going to be judged by God. But in Ephesians chapter 6, reading from verse 16, above all, taking the shield of faith. Amen. How do you overcome? Shield of faith. I said, how do you overcome? Shield of faith. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench what? Tell me out aloud. All the fiery darts of the wicked. It's my faith. And look at this. And take the helmet of salvation. And tell me. What is that? The word of God, and the sword of the spirit, which is the word of God. That's how we overcome. That's how I'm going to overcome. That's how you are going to overcome. And no evil will conquer you in Jesus' name. Don't you remember any mountain before you? If you say to this mountain, be thou removed and be cast into the sea, it shall obey you, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. And it says, if two of you shall agree as touching anything that you agree here on earth, it will be done for you in heaven in Jesus' name. And it says, and thou shalt decree a thing, and it shall be done unto thee. And it says, whatever you want, anything you want, ask the Father in my name, he'll give it to you. If we have all those promises, why would I carry a sword? Why will you carry a sword? Why you carry a stick? Why you go to, we're protesting, and then you go on the streets, and then we're shouting slogans, and we're saying, no, we're going to topple everything, we're going to destroy everything. That's not our weapon. That's not our way. That's not our style. Whether on the street, in the school, in the college, at the university, in the church, anywhere, we're not going to use those physical things and say we're going to overcome. And then in our families, against each other, husband against wife, a wife against husband, children against their parents, we're not going to use all those physical things. Whatever we need, we go on our knees before God, and God will do it for you. I'm talking to my brother there, I say God will do it for you. I'm talking to my sister, daughter there, I say God will do it for you. No fighting. Where are you? I said no fighting. No sword. We're going to overcome. You have overcome. Rise up and tell the Lord, I've overcome. We don't need a sword. We don't need a stick. We don't need the protest. We don't need any other thing. We have overcome. Remember the study today. Remember Judas has cut what he chose. Remember the Lord Jesus Christ, he submitted himself. Remember Peter, the mistake he made, you will not make that mistake again. And the Lord is saying today, whatever you ask, he'll give to you. Why are you going to fight with physical weapons? Let's call upon the name of the Lord and let the study of tonight be part of our lives.